And now we'll go to Central Asia.
Yeah, now we would be moving to the two regions we are working on. Central Asia, South Asia. I will be presenting a few information on Central Asia, and then Deepa will follow on the South Asia region. What is interesting for Central Asia is that, in theory, the region shouldn't have any problem of water, because the region is, in fact, water-rich. You have, if you compare by cubic meter per year, Central Asia has 3 times more water than the Middle East, and almost 10 times more water than Northern Africa. So it shouldn't be a problem, but it is one, because this water is very distributed in a very uneven way. You have two countries with big, which we consider the two water tower, Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, which control a vast share of the flows of the two main rivers, the Amuraya and the Siraya, but which are also the two poorest countries of the region. And on the other side, you have the three downstream countries, Kazakhstan, Uzbekistan, and Turkmenistan, which are require a large amount of water to irrigate their arable lands. Moreover, even if, and that's to follow what Marcus said about climate change, even if Central Asia is in theory rich in water, the situation for this region will deteriorate in the decades to come because of climate change. We know that it will really have drastic effect on the glacier of the Tian Shan and the Pamir in the decades ahead, and it will necessitate profound changes in water use. And we already noticed several of them. And here that's another map in climate change where you can see that Central Asia is not among the worst, but it will be relatively still affected, and that's something that our NGOs in the region are already trying to take into consideration. What is important is that, as many other regions in the world, water issues in Central Asia do not result from a natural lack of water, but instead from a complex interplay of political, geopolitical, economic, and social reasons. And of course, one of the most famous examples of this inability mismanagement of water issues in the region has been the catastrophe of the Aral Sea, that is now really a dying sea that will not be able to come back. We know that more or less the small Kazakh part of the Aral Sea will probably survive, but the big part of the Uzbek Sea will disappear. It's already now even less than that, and in about 20 years, it will probably nothing will probably remain of the old Aral Sea, and it's of course creating huge social pressure and tension for all the regions around, and not only the littoral regions. We can see the effect of the Aral Sea in terms of deterioration of soil, several hundreds of kilometers far away, of even thousands of kilometers far away from the Aral Sea itself. This is one of the most comprehensive maps we have on water management issues in Central Asia. It's almost a too complicated map because everything is there, both the ecological, environmental issues, but also the big energy project. And that's one of really the specificity of the region, is that water management is an issue in particular because it is connected to energy management. So it's really the water-energy nexus which is dysfunctional in Central Asia, maybe even more than in some other regions. Because of this water-energy dysfunctionment, you have huge geopolitical tensions that have been emerging since the early 90s, but very more visibly in the 2000s, especially between Uzbekistan on one side, Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan on the other side. And as experts of the region, we really consider that one of the critical elements where there is a real risk of interstate wars. That's really the only moment where the official narrative of the states, and especially of Uzbekistan, is mentioning sending army to Tajikistan if new dams and hydropower stations are built. So that's really a kind of moment where the state narrative is a very aggressive one. These big energy tensions are linked to the fact that Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, as I said, are the two poorest countries of the region, but they have the richest, they are the richest one in terms of water resources. They have a huge, among the first in the world, potential for hydroelectricity, and of course they would like to be able to use it. So you have several big projects that are currently underway. One in Kyrgyzstan of creating two big power stations in Kambarata, but the big kind of the most geopolitical, the big problem creating the most tension in the region is the Tajik project of having a huge, it would be the highest dam in the world that could potentially, and that the narrative of the other side, of the Uzbek side, that could dramatically impact the way Uzbekistan is able to irrigate its cotton production and its globally its arable land. So all these geopolitical issues are really important, and they are kind of also framing the way our NGOs can work at the everyday level. It's, for example, difficult for NGOs working on water issues in Tajikistan and in Uzbekistan to cooperate just because the relationship between the two states are very tense. These water energy nexus are also have a kind of regional impact, and that's why it was I really wanted to mention them here, because one of the big strategy that is developing now of reintegration of Afghanistan into the regional environment, both with Central Asia and with South Asia, is to develop this hydropower, hydroelectricity connection. So for Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, their goal is very much to be able to export hydroelectricity to South Asia and especially to Afghanistan and then to India and Pakistan. And in fact, even if we want have US policy told us we want to promote regional integration and water project can be a great tool for water for regional cooperation. They are also creating new wave of tensions between the, now on one side Uzbekistan, on the other side Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan are in fact fighting over the possibility in the future of exporting their electricity to South Asia. So all these geopolitical elements are really important. But if we want really to go back to what is the topic we will be discussing here today, it's really we need to look at more the local level. And what I will briefly try to show you is that water use in Central Asia, it's largely an issue of misused. Therefore, it's an issue of governance. As I said, there is enough water for everybody in Central Asia if this water was used in a very kind of normal, responsible manner. As you know, the Soviet Union was known for its water-intensive agriculture, and we have seen the result with the Aral Sea. But the newly independent Central Asian countries are in fact continuing exactly the same policies. In many points, they are just following the Soviet policy. They want to increase their agricultural production in terms of cotton, rice, or different cereals, and they want to develop their arable lands in the name of food security. So sometimes food security and water management are contradictory to one another, because it's in the name of their food security that they are in fact misusing the water they have. The problem also is that the deterioration of irrigation facilities due to a lack of state resources invested by the independent state has really dramatically aggravated the situation. And we know now that between 30 and 60% of the water flows are lost through because of evaporation or leakage because of the degradation of this irrigation channel. And that's really a very high, a very important level of losing half of your water because of the degradation of your irrigation channel. So you had decades of mismanagement of water during Soviet time, but you also had a quarter of century of mismanagement of water by the new Central Asian state. We see now that we have an increased amount of land which is contaminated with salt, we have stagnant pools of water, we have polluted groundwater, artificial lakes full of chemicals that are really declining, that are really contributing in declining the quality of water, but also in declining agricultural production. And all that has a massive impact on the health. And I now would like to show you this, what I think is the most kind of revealing numbers we have to show you how it's a governance issue. We did these numbers of water overconsumption. Central Asian countries are just the first in the world in terms of consumption of water in a cubic meter per capita. They are largely before the United States, which is already a not very good user of water. If you compare, for example, relatively similar climate, Turkmenistan on one side Ethred on another one. You can see how much Ethred has been able to develop to become a huge agricultural country without using a lot of water. So it's really an issue of overconsumption. It's not that water is missing, it's that water is misused. And that's really the key element. And so in fact, probably the majority of policy recommendation we would have to do after looking at this number is really not to, and really to work on the consumption and not on the distribution of water, because that's really the key element. The last point I would like to mention is that the water use is really a social issue, and then we will be going closer to the topic we are discussing today and to the role of the work of our NGOs and our participants here. Is that this water is very unevenly distributing within Central Asian society. As I said, Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan are the two water tower of the region, but at the same time, they are the two poorest of the region. The GDP per inhabitant is about $3,000 a year, a little bit less for Tajikistan, a little bit more for Kyrgyzstan. It's still very low, especially for post-Soviet countries. We have half of the population in both countries, Kyrgyzstan and Tajikistan, working on the agricultural sector, which is really a sector with very challenging conditions because the transition from state-run collective farm to private farming didn't happen without any big social, economic, and cultural trauma put on the societies. Both Tajikistan and Kyrgyzstan are also largely shaped by labor migration. In both countries, you have about 1 million person living, working in other countries, mostly in Russia, as migrants. And remittances, Tajikistan is the first country in the world in terms of remittances. Half of the Tajik GDP is based on remittances. These remittances and this huge flow of migration, they also have a huge impact, in fact, on water management, because it means that they put even more pressure on the role of women who are left alone in the rural regions to manage water and to take care of the agricultural production. And both countries are also disaster prone. They are both located in seismic zones and they are both mountainous. And therefore, access to water is really something challenging. Even in the two capital cities, Bishkek and Dushanbe, the access to drinkable water is not secure and the water is often of very bad quality. So therefore, you have many sanitation issues, and of course the situation is worse in rural regions. In Tajikistan, more than 50% of the rural population cannot access water through a centralized water supply system, which means that they have to rely on springs, wells, irrigation ditches, and irrigation canals to take their water. Usually this water is contaminated. It's really a danger for the health of the population, and we can see since the collapse of the Soviet Union the rise of infectious diseases, which are mostly coming from the decline in water quality in both regions. The water pipes are often very old, as I said, and therefore they do not meet sanitary requirements, and we know that in these conditions women are often the first one having to suffer of this deterioration of the water quality because they are the one working with water every day, and it's also, of course, impacting children. The situation is relatively similar in Kyrgyzstan. There also half of the rural population cannot easily access water. We know that one quarter of the rural population, only one quarter of the rural population has access to water 24 hours a day, which means that three quarters of them have to walk often on very long distance to access water, and the sanitation situation is also deteriorating. At the same time, you have many initiatives that are done on the ground, at the grassroots level, by each communities in trying to solve these issues, and so our kind of bleak description of the situation will be compensated by what you will hear during our second and third panel, because many NGOs are working on the ground in improving the local situation in each community with often very innovative system and cheap system. So they are able to function almost by themselves, sometimes with the help of international organization or international NGOs. Some awareness programs are developing. So things people are very acting on the ground, and they are doing their best and creating more and more new programs to improve water access. At the same time, the general deterioration of the infrastructure is going so fast that even if people are working a lot in improving the situation on the ground, the general situation is that of a deterioration of the water access, both in terms of sanitation requirement and just in terms of accessing water. So I will stop here and I will give the floor to Deepa for an overview of the South Asian situation. Thank you.